On July 4th, 1952, a god among men was born. John Ronald Balfour. This is his story.
Well, it's one for the money.
At an early age, in his hometown of Toronto, Canada, John was shown the wonders of public transportation, the Toronto subway and bus system. From that point on, he took a great interest in all kinds of transportation, especially environmentally friendly mass transit. Darkness fell upon little Johnny when he left the land of milk and honey and moved to the barren wastelands of Arizona. When John started high school, he ran into problems with the transportation system in Phoenix, which paled in comparison to the one he had left behind. The buses were unreliable and indirect because of their hub-and-spoke system. This meant a rider would have to go to the central hub downtown before they went on to their final destination, making a bus trip even longer. John would often hitch rides to school and around town, but that was dangerous, as violence against hitchhikers had become an issue. The city was also plagued with pollution and traffic-clogged streets. When John started college in the early 70s at Arizona State University, he had the same difficulties getting to school. ASU was even farther from his home, and owning a car was expensive and difficult at a school with little parking. Around the same time, San Diego, California was dealing with the same problems as Phoenix: congestion, pollution, and hitchhiking. Jack Haberstroh, a San Diego University professor, decided to do something about the rising level of violence against women who hitchhiked. His solution was to get people on the bus, the San Diego Bugline.
The reason why he started it, he tells a story that he was homesick one day watching the news. And at the time, hitchhiking was a big phenomenon, everyone was doing it. And San Diego had a problem with violence against hitchhikers, particularly women. And he thought it was horrible, and I thought it could easily be taken care of, that he can get a bus system going. And he told me that he was sitting there saying, okay, how do you save these people? You get them on buses. Well, how do you get buses? You need to find a way to make it pay for itself. How do you make it pay for itself? You sell advertising and all of that. You need to make them outrageous. So he had involved the students of his class, one of his marketing classes, to adopt it as a project. And I think that's when they came up with the bug idea. And I'm trying to think if originally he thought he'd make them as vegetables. I don't know, giant carrot or something like that. And then someone else came up with the idea of making them as bugs. But the idea was make it look outrageous so they would be noticed. So then people would sell advertising, and then that would fund it. Also, the other idea was to connect it to where people wanted to go. And the beaches were really popular in San Diego: Mission Beach, Pacific Beach. And so students would hitchhike back and forth to the beaches. And that's also where a lot of the neighborhoods were going into San Diego State, which is more on the east end of San Diego.
The system worked wonderfully. Students crammed the buses, and the service made a profit. Meanwhile, John had a work-study job at the city of Phoenix, where he learned of the San Diego Bugline. His moment of greatness came when he realized that this was the solution to his and many others' transportation issues. He pitched the idea to his political science class and found his new partner, Eddie Sears. With their long hair and just-do-it attitudes, the two formed a corporation to pursue the idea. They called it BS Enterprises, for Balfour and Sears, of course. They presented the idea to the city of Phoenix and wrote a memo to John Wentz, the city manager. They cited the dangers of hitchhiking and traffic congestion as reasons to establish the service. Interested, Phoenix sent John and Eddie to San Diego to learn more. Their plan was to provide a free bus service from Christown Mall to ASU. 36 miles round trip, paid fully by advertisements all over the bus. Anyone could ride, and there were to be many stops in between. BS Enterprises began to sell advertising for the buses, and although few believed the bus idea would fly, they were given a $5,000 grant by the Phoenix City Council and a $15,000 loan from the Valley National Bank. John and Eddie headed to Los Angeles, where they purchased two 25-year-old, 45-passenger buses for $2,500 each. Neither had driven a bus before, so they were given a quick 15-minute lesson around the block before heading to San Diego to have the buses turned into giant bugs by Mike Madsen, who did the fiberglass work on the San Diego bugs. In December of 1973, the Bugline made its first run with Phoenix Mayor John Driggs and Phoenix Council members Margaret Hance and Calvin Good on the bus. The Bugline had the support of Phoenix, Scottsdale, and Tempe, but ASU was not as cooperative until the Arizona governor, Jack Williams, stepped in. With everyone behind them, the Bugline was ready to roll.
All of the members of the city council showed up except for one, which is kind of interesting because if they had done that now without making that an official city council meeting, it'd be against the law. There was an incredible amount of media there. Newspapers, TVs, radio. It's funny to see the people who were doing radio, TV, and newspapers back then, seeing them go through their careers over the last 30 years.
On the first day of service, January 17, 1974, the Bugline carried over 700 passengers.
I think it was a total of 5 round trips on that day. And we expected a fairly good turnout, but we turned away somewhere between 350 and 450 people that day. We filled every bus beyond capacity. In other words, it was standing room only all the way from Christmas. It was standing room only all the way back. And we also, that first day, organized probably 200 or 300 carpools for the people who couldn't get on. And that was really the beginning of the Arizona State University carpool program. Because until that time, nobody had ever put together a focal point to make it happen. And here we had hundreds of people that couldn't get to school unless they carpooled, and they did. And some of those carpools lasted for years.
Over the next 2.5 years, the Phoenix community and ASU students rode the Bugline. 45-passenger buses were usually full of riders doing homework, engaged in bus-wide discussions, or listening to rock music. As the buses followed their routes, many people stopped and stared at the giant purple and orange bugs crawling the streets.
We let people know that anybody could ride the Bugline. You didn't have to be a student. And I can remember one morning over by North High, two little old ladies got on and sat up front And the one was just all excited, and she said, "See, I told you we could get on, and I told you it was going to be free." And they just didn't stop till they got off at Tower Plaza. That was like the high point of their week. And we often had people, we had people come from out of state to ride the bus and take pictures. And can we have pictures with the driver? And can we have, and it was very entertaining. It was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun.
It wasn't all smooth sailing for John and Eddie.
We haven't been quite as successful as we wanted. We're probably 60% a little bit more full at the moment. And we really do need some more support from the business community, because we feel it's a good service to the people. A lot of people ride it. There's been great response from those passengers who have written letters to the Arizona Republic, and the Gazette, and to the city manager and the mayor. We feel it's also a good form of advertising for them. It's useful, and it's doing something for the community at the same time.
With fuel hard to get and the national recession in 1975, the Bugline had nowhere to go except to the Arizona Corporation Commission for a certificate of necessity and convenience. This would allow the Bugline to provide charter bus service and collect donations during the daily runs. Many riders supported this and were willing to pay for rides to keep the bugs alive.
They suggested $12.50 a month, and I'd be willing to pay that.
I'd be willing to pay for the direct ride up quite a bit, because it saves wear on the car and wear on myself.
Well, the major thing right now is the fact that the state laws would prohibit something like this. They're set up to protect the companies that are running now. And these laws may have been effective for 30 years ago or 40 years ago, but they don't pertain anymore. We feel that with what our budget came out to last year, if we charged our riders 25 cents a ride, we would have made a profit for the year 1974. Whereas other companies are saying, we can't make money, we're losing money, we need to be subsidized. We don't want a subsidy. We can make it.
When the ACC denied the charter, the Bugline's last real option to earn operating revenue was gone, and it was the beginning of the end for the buses. In mid-1976, the bugs stopped crawling, and John sold the buses in 1977. One bus was sold to a Save the Whales activist, but it disappeared after his death in 1980, and the fate of the buses is unknown.
Harry had a 20-year-old and an 18-year-old who started a bus system, who got money out of the city of Phoenix to run buses. You know, they didn't know anything about, they never driven a bus until they bought one. They had never ran a business before, didn't have any idea about the business. Had a heck, we can do it anyway attitude, jumped in there and did it. Was able to get all the support, make an impact. And I always ask groups that come in today, could this happen today? And everybody says, no, there is no way it can happen today.
The success of the Bugline encouraged the creation of new cross-town Phoenix bus routes and helped push ASU to reform their parking rules and create a formal carpool service.
City officials are not claiming that the expanded bus service will solve all of the valley's bus problems, but they feel it will add one more link in a total transportation program. For Channel 10, Kent Dana, Cool News.
Based on what Ed Colby, who was the next transit administrator, told us, he said to both of us, John and Eddie, he said, "I want to thank you for the work you've done, because you've saved me 5 years of convincing city management and the city council what they needed to do to improve the bus line. We ran the first crosstown service from West Phoenix to Arizona State University since World War II. We were the beginning of express service in the valley, we were the beginning of crosstown service in the valley, and we were arguing for quite a while that instead of having everything go downtown, you really needed to go crosstown. So what ended up coming out of our work was that instead of having a, quote, hub and spoke type of transit system, we ended up having a modified grid system which took advantage of the city streets."
I met Johnny my freshman year at Phoenix College. He was right away, you know, interesting character, the hair, and that was the time of angry young men. And Johnny was different. He had anger, good anger, but he also was the guy with a grin on his face, like he was always plotting something. And what I learned real soon when talking to John is his plots came about. They had substance to them.
I was going to, I was in finance, and let's see, that was in 74. So I just probably through information brochures or something, picked it up. But I lived over by Phoenix College. On Thomas, and so the bus came right down Thomas, stopped right there in front of the Phoenix College, right in front of my apartment, matter of fact. So I just have to fall out the door, go and get on the bus and ride it in down Thomas and then down Scottsdale Road into ASU. And I do remember, you know, reading some in the state press, they'd have articles about it, you know, they need financial help or, you know, the troubles that they were going through.
One thing I do remember about the Bugline is that, in fact, I was a bit jealous. I felt a little bit slighted because the Bugline was not going where I was going. I liked it because it was free and was a really cool-looking bus, but it was shuttling out to Tempe, and I was going to Glendale Community College, which was totally the other way. But the concept was fabulous. The ideas, you know, to me, to have everyone carpool together in these great buses was fantastic. And amongst, you know, my friends and that, we couldn't believe that somebody actually was able to get this thing off the ground. I didn't know John then. All I knew is there were some freaky people that actually got this thing through to the city.
What I remember about the Bugline, and I remember the Bugline, and I have to confess, I never was on the Bugline, but I was behind it, you know, a few times in traffic, and I had, you know, I once in a while was going to get on it, but I missed it or something happened. But what I remember about the Bugline was all the good-looking women were on the Bugline. And there was this one particular gal that just stole my heart. She used to ride the Bugline a lot.
It was good because it was different, and at that time, I was like, say, with the long hair and dressing funny and anything different was cool.
And I remember when John first mentioned this idea to me, and I have to confess, I was not an early believer. I'm going, what? But, you know, John made a believer of me and a lot of other people too, so.
And I can remember being somewhere, it was at a dinner theater for a program at one point in time. And I know it was a school event for some schools, and this guy kept smiling at me. I thought there was something funny with him. And finally he walked over, he says, "John, you don't know who I am, do you?" And I said, "I don't have a clue." And he said, "I just wanted you to know that I was a student at ASU about 15 or 20 years ago, and I rode the Bugline every day for 4 semesters. And if I couldn't have ridden the Bugline, I wouldn't have been able to afford the transportation costs to finish my degree." He said, "I'm a teacher, and I'm here with my students." And he said, "I love being a teacher." He said, "Nothing makes me happier than my job." And he said, "If it wasn't for what you did, I might be doing something else right now." And he said, "Thank you." And I started crying then, I'm almost crying now. And there were stories like that that kept coming back.
From April 2004 to January 2005, an exhibit at the Tempe Historical Museum once again brought the Bugline to life. Young and old were able to enjoy the history of these lovable buses. John Balfour continued working in Phoenix Transit and also moved on to working with solar and other alternative energies. He currently owns a company that specializes in renewable energy products and is continuing on his quest to save the world.
We'll be right back. every day. Just to drive to my baby. From 10, 6 months each day. Cause I drive my baby.
Magic bus. I drive my baby in my magic bus.